English professor Victor Okada speaks in his book, Triumphs of Faith. The broad outlines of what was endured by Japanese Americans as a result of Executive Order 9066 are by now clear to most Americans. It was on February 19, 1942, in the midst of war with Japan, that President Franklin Delano Roosevelt signed the order resulting in the removal of all Japanese Americans on the West Coast, from their homes to concentration camps in America's most desolate wastelands.
Well, this evacuation and going into a concentration camp is certainly almost inhuman.
Well, we lost almost everything because all we could take was what we could carry. Some things we stored at a Caucasian church, but majority of, well, all the furniture and everything was gone.
Even today, the names of those camps, Manzanar, California, Poston, Arizona, Heart Mountain, Wyoming, Topaz, Utah, Granada, Colorado, Gila River, Arizona, Minidoka, Idaho, Jerome, Arkansas, Rower, Arkansas, and Tule Lake, California, conjure up distant memories. Barbed wire and sentry towers, searchlights piercing the night sky, noisy mess halls, barracks with walls too thin and too ridden with knot holes to keep private conversations from the ears of strangers, communal toilets and showers, bitter cold, oppressive heat, swirling dust. In all, over 120,000 persons, most of them citizens, were dislocated, their lives forever altered.
We found snakes and scorpions and gila monster just crawling, and if a person get bitten or died, either 20 minutes or within 20 minutes, or anyway, it's a terrible place to reside.
In the 1930s and the early 1940s, APU's former institutions were missionary training grounds. This is the story of 24 of over 80 students who attended our former institutions, the Missionary Training School for Christian Workers, LAPC, and Pacific Bible College.
I had to preach at a mission on Wilmington, which is right on the wharf. So I got in my car and I went into this restricted area. And then there was a person with a flashlight, and he flashed it in my face. He says, "What are you doing here?" And I said, "Well, I have a little church down here, and I'm the pastor and I have to preach." They said, "Oh, come on now, don't give me that." I said, "Well, and I had my Bible. And I showed him my Bible and my notes. I was going to preach that sermon that night. And then he became understanding and he said, "Okay, I'll let you go. Hurry up and get your service over with and get out of here."
Only because of their race, our honorees' college years were affected by the evacuation from their homes. Given only 2 weeks or less, they had to leave their schools, neighborhoods, vehicles, furniture, and all their belongings and take only what they could carry. Armed guards enforced the executive order. and armed guards supervised their removal to destinations unknown. The future seemed uncertain.
We had to be forcefully moved from our location, whether you had a job or going to school or whatever. And all you can take with you is what you can carry.
In Georgiane Helburian Ikuma's article in APU Life, Hope and Faith, she explains the history of our program today. In October 2009, California Governor Arnold Schwarzenegger signed into law Assembly Bill 37, directing the state's community college, California State Universities, and the University of California Systems to locate and award honorary degrees to their former Japanese-American students. Although private universities are not required to follow suit under this law, the APU community enthusiastically and unanimously supported the implementation of its own reconciliatory project. By honoring these former students, one can see the faithfulness of our God and how He brought these young Christian students through the dark period in U.S. history with a faith that was stronger than their circumstances.
Although I didn't know we were afraid of the unknown, God knew the path, and He guided us through those dark times. And no amount of darkness could put out His light. And He made those rough places smooth. Something good came out of our time in internment camp.
Most of our students were like me, my father, and his siblings. We were all born into our citizenship as American citizens. My family has been in the United States for nearly 100 years. My dad was what they called Nisei, the second generation. The images of shipping tags tied onto the clothing of young and elderly evacuees were reminiscent of the stars seen in Holocaust photos sewn into the clothing of Jewish Holocaust victims to distinguish them from the rest of the population. The woman in this now famous photo was asked decades later what she carried in the only bag she was allowed to carry. She answered, diapers. She was expecting a new baby as she carried her older toddler to the evacuation station.
And all of a sudden, one Caucasian fellow, white guy, comes in there, "You damn Jap!" said right in my face. And I couldn't understand why he should call me a damn Jap when I'm just having my lunch there.
One of the biggest areas of discrimination was this inability to work, because they were not able to buy fertilizer or seeds to grow the vegetables that they wanted to grow. During the same time that there were some Caucasian people that were friendly and knew that they weren't a threat, and so that they would go and buy the seeds and the fertilizer for them, so that at least they could have something to grow and have some type of small livelihood. But it really was a challenge, because someone had to actually go and get it for you, and you weren't able to get it as it was needed.
One of our honorees seen here, a young Hopi Fujiu, was part of the famous 442nd Regimental Unit. This unit was segregated. Its makeup, only Americans of Japanese ancestry. The 442nd were sent to fight in the European theater. They were given the task of rescuing a lost battalion of Caucasian soldiers. The regimental unit, I believe, remains the most decorated U.S. Army unit in U.S. history, losing more members of their unit than those they rescued.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America. The fact is, the children in the concentration camp had to do it. And I just wondered, you know, when he said, for liberty and justice for all but us, you know.
The president of Los Angeles Pacific College, Cedor Demery, offered me a job at a time when jobs were very scarce for Japanese Americans. I thought it was a very kind gesture on his part to offer me this bookkeeping secretarial job, and everyone there were so kind. And I think it affected my whole life, thinking back, because I was able to get other jobs through the years in bookkeeping, accounting, and even as a pastor's wife, I was able to use the skills that I learned at LAPC. I know the Baptists in Los Angeles, they strategized before we went to camp, and they were determined that we would not miss one single Sunday of worship. And they also provided hymnals, and I think that was real important to me, who loved music.
After internment in the camp, he ended up going to the Midwest, and he met my mother in Chicago. They became missionaries to Japan, and everybody, so many people have told me what a team they were working together in Japan on the mission field, and one could not have done it without the other. They were primarily working with university students, and as a result of their work there, they were there for as missionaries for 31 years, and as a result of their work there, today in Japan there are 31 of their former students in full-time Christian service in Japan. So you can see that through all of the hardship and all of the difficulties, God's plan was being carried out.
It is my privilege to introduce you to our honorees today. Reverend Hideo Aoki, Doctor of Humane Letters, honoris causa, awarded posthumously, accepted by his daughter.
I know that she'd be very appreciative, probably a little embarrassed, you know, of the attention that's being brought to her. She would just be thankful and grateful. She was able to do something with her life. And I think it's very exciting that she's getting this honorary degree from Azusa Pacific, because even our organization partners with APU. She helped start Heavenly Treasures, which is a mission organization that we network to help the poor. And I'm the founder of that organization, and because we were so close, she really could see my heart to help people that she would never see herself.
I appreciate the efforts of the university in honoring my dad and other former students who were not able to graduate. And above all, that God will be honored and glorified through this whole program.
So we went in the trains and we tried to bolster our optimism in such a way that we wouldn't get too downhearted. And we began to sing songs like, "Are We Downhearted? No, no, no." "Are We Downhearted? No, no, no," you know. And then a lot of the other choruses that we learned in church that would keep us rejoicing in spite of what was happening. "Are we downhearted? No, no, no. Are we downhearted? No, no, no. Troubles may come and troubles may go. We trust in Jesus, come weal or woe. Are we downhearted? Are we downhearted? No, no, no."
So this story and having this kind of information is absolutely critical, because firstly, it's a part of American history. And they're probably not going to tell their own story, so their children need to tell their story. Now, their children don't know the story because they didn't tell them. So all we've got to go on are bits and pieces of documentation and pictures that perhaps are preserved in churches all around this area, and we have the memories of people. As faulty as those memories like mine are, that's all we've got to go on. So in attempting to put this puzzle back together again so that we preserve a significant part of American history, it's important that we have this kind of information collected. And I'm grateful that APU could be possibly a place, a repository of all of this, to bring it together to create a mosaic that describes this part of American history. So having this story told is really vitally important. It's historical, it's spiritual, it's theological, it's educational, it's generational for the children who come after them. It's essential that we do these kinds of projects to collect this kind of information, and for the students at APU and other institutions who can benefit from this.